Great. Well, welcome, everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening from wherever you're coming in. It's a pleasure to have you. And thanks so much for taking time out of your day to join us for this talk, basically, but really conversation in many ways. And so why this panel? As we were discussing with the organizers, different possibilities, the thought came to me because I absolutely love Ted Lasso and the show. What about connecting different episodes to negotiation theory and practice? For those of us who are all connected, which is many of us, to the world of negotiation, there's endless examples, there's endless scenes, there's endless stories. Many of them are not formal negotiations, but if you watch this from a negotiation with a negotiation lens, you see them happening constantly and throughout the entire show. And they're done beautifully. One of the things I love about the show is not only the wit and the humor, but also the fact that they're unafraid to tackle difficult issues, difficult challenges, and put ideas out there for us to really think about. So that's why we wanted to do this, to kind of take that theory and practice lens that we all work with and apply it to a few different specific episodes and snippets even within those episodes. So again, remember, these are not necessarily formal negotiations. In fact, many of them are not at all. And you have to be viewing things from the point of view of what are they trying to achieve here in this particular situation? Now, I'm not going to apologize for the language that's in this, because if you've watched Ted Lasso, that's part of it. And so that's going to be part of today. And I hope it doesn't offend anybody, but I'm pretty sure if you're here, it isn't going to. You will also notice that this is Ted and Friends negotiating. It's not just Ted, but there are a number of scenes that we're picking up on where other people, the one that I'm going to talk about is Rebecca, et cetera. So you'll see that. Let me just give you a quick idea of how this is going to work. And honestly, I wish we had 5 hours to do this, but we have an hour. And maybe we'll leak over a little bit. So if you can stay, please do. And we are recording this. So if you do need to leave and you want to pick up on the pieces that you missed, absolutely. So what we're going to do is we have four presenters, and each one is going to show, explain a little bit about the clip that they're going to share. Then they're going to share the clip. And then they're going to provide a bit of an analysis of what they saw from a negotiation point of view. Ideally, we would have a conversation at that point about it, but I just don't think we're going to have time. It's looking like we're going to have about 10 to 12 minutes for each of us to sort of talk through our negotiation scenario. And we want to try to leave at least 10 to 15 minutes at the end for a conversation, for questions, comments, et cetera. And so that's the plan. And at the very end, I want to, a little bit like Marvel movies or things like that, I don't want you to get up and leave, because I want to share with you one more clip that I think for most of us working in the field of negotiation epitomizes a very important part of negotiation. And so that's the little hanger on or teaser kind of idea that hopefully you'll stay with us to see what that last little bit looks like. Okay, so please do share your comments and questions. We are absolutely not going to be able to get to all of them, and I'm sorry about that, but we will get to some for sure. The order is going to be, Keld is going to go first, and for the presenters, if you could just give us, maybe 30 seconds to a minute on who you are and why you're sitting here, that'd be terrific. Then dive in, and we'll go from there to there. So Keld, let me turn it over to you, my friend.
Ryan, thank you, Josh. And first and foremost, Josh is the one that came up with the idea. And I thought it was a great idea, so I jumped on it immediately. So thank you for being creative here, Josh, and let us all share a little bit of knowledge on how we can interpret a program like Ted Lasso. Very briefly, my name is Keld. I am based in Southern California, where I just talked to Debbie before we started, and she said, it must be wonderful there. No, it's not. It's overcasted and rainy and cloudy, and it's been like that for months. So I need to talk to the guy who wrote the song It Never Rains in Southern California, because he's wrong. But anyway, I'm based originally from Denmark, been in the US for many, 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 many years and working globally on negotiation. I'm an associate professor at a university here in the US, Thunderbird School of Global Management, and also at a university in Denmark, Belgium, and Lithuania. And I run a consultancy company where we advise government and private organizations on negotiations globally. And then I'm an author and write books on negotiations as well. Anyway, the clip I'm going to share with you today is actually not with Ted. There are so many great negotiations in there. And I, as just said earlier, we could just go on and on and on and keep showing clips from this show. But I actually want to start off by saying, if anybody who's attending today have ever really been thinking about how many negotiations you have during a year, I often ask my audience that. And I ask, how many of you believe you have more than 1,000 negotiations per year? And already there, I see people going, that can't be right. 1,000, that's a lot. That's 2, 3, 4 negotiations per day. That seems like a lot. But some people raise their hand and say, oh, yes, absolutely. And then I raised the bar and said, how many of you believe you have 5,000 negotiations per year? And then there's only a few people left. And then I shock people by saying, do you know what? You actually have between 8 to 10,000 negotiations per year. And I can see a lot of people just think I'm crazy, thinking that is impossible. But in the small clip that I'll show you, which is 1 minute and 30 seconds, we have about 10, 11, 12 negotiations. And I probably forgot some. Now, you could all say, is it small negotiation within the same negotiation? Yes, it is. But let's just say then that it's just one negotiation that is 1.5 minutes. And then we have a bunch of other negotiations during that day. So we have negotiation with ourselves, with our spouses, with our parents, with our boss, with our management, with our suppliers, with the waitress at the restaurant that we're going to watch right now, and so on and so forth. Anyway, let's get into the fun part. Let's show the clip, and then I'm going to share the background very quickly. Nate, who is the assistant coach, who leaves the club at one point and then comes back, I can probably say that without being wrong, he's a little bit not aggressive, but passive aggressive, but he grows during the whole show. So he's a little bit of a concessional orientated individual, and we'll see that because he's also very dominated by his dad. So there's a negotiation going on right there. But let's just dive in. And let me share the clip with you, because that basically just explains a lot of what it is we want to talk about. And here we go. I hope you can see my screen. Could you all just nod if you can see the screen? That is perfect. Okay, let's watch it. The part.
Hello, Shelley, party of three.
Let's see, Shelley.
No, my name. Sorry, yes, that's correct. In fact, that's all our names. That's my dad there and my mum as well. We're all Shelleys. A gaggle of Shelleys.
Stop blabbing at the young lady. Your mother's hungry.
Stop it, Lloyd. Forgive your father, my darling. He's been wanting the Saganaki all week.
As you may remember, it's our 35th wedding anniversary. Jade.
Of course. Right this way.
Sorry, if you remember, I requested the window table.
Sir, we don't take reservations for the window table.
Excuse me one moment. Right back. Don't get too comfortable. Jade, this is a special night for my parents, and the window table is open, so here is what I would love to see happen. You're going to give us that table, and then my family and I are going to order a starter, main course, little dessert, bottle of wine, and you are going to be stunned by how quickly a gaggle of Shelleys can get through a three-course meal and get out of it. So what do you say?
Okay.
Mum, Dad. Perhaps you'd like to give me a number as well.
No, that's okay. Sorry, I'm picky.
No, me too.
I'm not a dog.
There you go. I'm just curious, actually, how many of you that obviously I helped a little bit with the text below, but how many of you that picked up all these negotiations that were just in this small clip right here? And obviously, when you're a little bit of a negotiation nerd, like the four of us hosting this thing today, you obviously are watching stuff like that and thinking that's a negotiation, that's a negotiation, that should be handled differently, and how you're doing that. But they all play so really well. And all the clips we have today, they all play really well. And during the whole show, I think is part of the reason it's such a huge success. They really act out so perfectly. Anyway, let me just take you through very quickly the items that is important here. The first situation we had is obviously Nate, as you can see, is very stressed. And he's stressed. If this was a commercial negotiation, he would be stressed by his management, which in this case is his dad. His mom is very supportive and helping and holding him and supporting him in many ways, but his dad is very dominant, as you can see. And Nate is constantly trying to get the approval. So if this was a commercial negotiation, he would be stressed stepping into this negotiation already, which he is. So you can actually see that Nate is stressed. So when he arrives and talks to Jade, the waitress, when she actually announces or share his names, he gets aggressive immediately because he thinks that she's pronouncing his name wrong. So he immediately gets up there because he's tense. So that shows you immediately you have a negotiator who's stressed even before that negotiation began. I quite often say a negotiation begins before we actually think it begun. And this is what's happening right here. The negotiation began already. Then we're moving into number two. And what we're seeing is that while Nate is standing there talking to Jade, his dad steps in and actually humiliate him in front of her by saying, stop talking, chatting to the girl right there. So again, you have the management in the back. So imagine you're sitting in a negotiation and you have your boss next to you and the boss is overruling you and telling you what you're doing right and wrong. That is obviously not a nice situation for the counterpart to be in. Then we move into number three, and where Nate is actually approaching Jade saying, I thought we had asked for the window table. That was what I reserved. And Jade is just saying, no, you can't reserve the window table, and walks away. Now, again, negotiation-wise, Nate should have been asking, why is the window table important for you? And what is the value if you're actually sitting at the window table? So again, if we move that into a negotiation context, she's just declining his question, could we get the window table? And then Nate is showing what I call unilateral concession, which is actually a terrible thing in most negotiations. We shouldn't just give something away. And he accepts that case right there. So he just accepts that Jade is saying you can't get the window table. So he's not saying anything else. But then he's doing something right. And the only thing he's basically doing right, he's doing two things right in this negotiation. He takes a break. And I always advise everybody, it's one of the most simple advices you could share with anybody in negotiation, use breaks. And a break doesn't have to be a day or a week. A break could be just like Nate right here. He takes 1 minute off, walks into the restroom, the toilet, and just stands in there looking at the mirror thinking, what happened right here? And he's taking some time. He is basically negotiating with himself. So if we add that to negotiations as well, then we can add the number of negotiations, this small clip. So he's standing in there figuring out what should I do right now. Then he comes back out and then he walks up to Jade and say, here is what I would love to see happen, which I just love that quote. Isn't that just a brilliant way of approaching something? Here's what I would love to see happen. Is it aggressive, combative? No, it's not. It's actually just an opening. Here's a potential proposal. Here's what I would love to see happen. And then he's actually offering a compromise by saying, you're going to be stunned how quickly we as a family can get out of here if we get the window table. So he's offering kind of a deal. Let's get the table and I can promise you we're not going to spend too much time. And compromise is actually not always a great solution to a negotiation, but obviously he's trying to get what he wants. Then Jade is accepting that, saying just yes. And that's a surprise, obviously, to Nate, because I don't think he expected that, even though he was out in the restroom negotiating with himself. And Jade is then a little bit concession orientated because, again, she's not saying, she's not bringing up a counteroffer. Again, a negotiation, you could have brought up a counteroffer saying, so I understand you really would like that window table. You can get it if you order an additional bottle of wine. Again, I'm just thinking commercial negotiation here. And then we see Nate being a little bit more confident. He's asking for her phone number as well because he's thinking this is going really well. So I'm just going all the way. And she declines that, saying, I'm picky. And then he says, well, I'm picky too. And then the dad comes up to him and again establishes his position by saying, I'm not a dog, because Nate was just whistling at him. So again, the dad is clearly showing in public, I'm the dominant figure, I'm the one in charge. And then the final clip, and this is the happy Disney ending, where you can see, and this is again why this show is so marvelous, The dad shows acknowledgement to Nate by having a small smile, nodding, and you can see Nate is now happy because he got the acknowledgement from his dad. So that was basically the negotiation that I would take you through. Thank you so much, guys. Over to you, Josh.
Great, Kel. That was terrific. And lots to unpack there, as you just showed us. Terrific. So we're going to go ahead and have Debbie Goldstein share her clip and conversation here. And as feel free to keep the conversation going in the chat. We may not, like I said, we may not be able to get to everything, but we can have folks be conversing there as we go. So Debbie, please.
Hi. So delightful to see everyone in such a large audience. And I saw in the chat from so many places. So I have the great privilege of teaching negotiation at Harvard Law School and at the Graduate School of Education, which means I teach lawyers and teachers negotiation. And so just put in the chat, who do you think has the harder negotiations, lawyers or teachers? Just put that in the chat, just as that's flowing. And the second part of my career path is that I run a global professional services firm that does leadership development. And many people are saying teachers, which means you either have children, maybe aggressively avoid children, whatever the case may be. Teachers are with children all day, just teachers. Think about that. The reality is we all have hard negotiations. And part of what I love about Ted Lasso is what I imagine many people love, which is that he brings such heart and kindness and sort of relentless goodness to his negotiations, as do many of the characters in the show. And you mentioned profanity, Josh, so I just have to share, because it sparked for me that I watched Ted Lasso during the pandemic, as many people did, because we all just needed that boost. And what I remembered about the show was just the goodness. And so I decided I needed to show my children this show. And so about 9 months after it first came out, I gathered my kids and we started binging it. And I had actually completely forgotten about the profanity. So as you mentioned, my kids are 5 years old and 8 years old at the time. So they were watching this with their mouths wide open. And then I had some very interesting parent-teacher conferences about the language that was being shared. Anyway, the clip that I'm going to share, which may say something about my parenting. So the clips that I want to talk about and then share a piece of goes back also, I believe this, the clip that Kel showed may have been in season one, and I'm going back to season one, too. So season one, episode 4 was an episode that many people remember because it was the Rebecca's big charity event. And what a lot of people remember is that Rebecca sang and Rupert tried to thwart her. But the clip that I want to talk about a little bit and then show the after effect of is actually Ted convening Roy Kent and Jamie Tart, who were 2-star players who were really at odds with each other and causing a lot of trauma for the team. And the reason why I'm showing this clip is because I think that Ted was playing a role that many of the panelists play, which is to be brought in as a facilitator of negotiation. I think we're often either like a party in a negotiation or we're facilitating it. And so in this moment, Ted is playing a facilitator role. And I'll describe a little bit of what he does and some of the lessons, and then we'll see a clip of the after effect. So Ted brings together at this charity event, Roy and Jamie, who are really fighting. They're quite cruel to each other. And what he says is, you've split our locker room and we're gonna fix this right now. And then what he says is, quote, tell me the biggest issue you have with each other. And he says, you know, we don't need to be big best friends to be great teammates, but you do need to have mutual respect. So who's going to go first? And even in this short, that's all he says. And he says it with humor and care, and he throws a few pop culture references in there. But for me, one of the most important negotiation lessons from that small moment, when he says, tell me the biggest issue you have with each other, is that we're often in negotiation trying to have parties understand each other's interests. What do they really care about? What are their needs, wants, concerns, motivations to negotiate? And you can get at interests by saying, what are you interested in? Or what do you care about? And you will often get good answers. But for me, the sort of hidden jewel, one of the best ways to access people's interests are actually to ask for critique. are to ask them, what is your beef with each other? What is the biggest issue you have with each other? Because people love to critique. And when you ask them for what they're unhappy with or what they are critiquing, if you can listen through the sort of emotional pain of getting critiqued, you're actually hearing what they care about. You're hearing their interests. So for me, this is just a brilliant move to really ascertain their interests, is to ask sort of what their issues are with each other. The second just general lesson of Ted Lasso, I think, but it shows up in this moment too, is that he does two things constantly. He has a relentless sort of desire to build relationship and affiliation with people, and he gives space for things to breathe. So at the end of that moment, he says, who's going to go first? And no one does. And then he says, okay, well, let me flip the question. Who wants a drink? And everyone's hand goes up. They want a drink. So he's laying groundwork. And I think that one of the things I think about as a negotiator and a facilitator, and I say this to my clients all the time, is I'm trying to get myself out of a job. I want to equip you with the skills to navigate these conversations and skill you up so that you don't need me anymore. So I want to show a clip of the after effect of Roy and Jamie's conversation after Ted gave this intro. So Keld, if you don't mind showing that clip. This is the two of them at the bar by themselves after Ted has laid this groundwork.
When I was coming up, there was this old geezer at the club, Doug Stashwick. He was always on me, hated each other. Do you want to know how we won the league?
No.
It was the same shit Yankee Doodle was peddling. He sat me down, he said, let's get it all out there. You tell me why I'm a prick, and I'll tell you why you are.
You're a nasty bastard.
No, I'm going first. Even though I know I should pass to you, you're so selfish and arrogant. Every time I do, it makes me want to fucking puke.
You know, I had a poster of you on my wall when I was a kid. I used to love watching you play. But you're not the player that you used to be. And just because you won a few trophies, you walk around here expecting everyone to kiss your ring.
Yeah, I can't be like that. Now's a bit where you admit to what I said.
I don't want it. Even if it is just a little bit true. You and that Doug bloke, you ever become friends?
Fuck no. I hope he's dead.
To you dying.
Such a prick.
So that shows that laying really helpful groundwork can set the stage for vulnerability, for the concept of joint contribution, where we're each sort of sharing the pieces that we've contributed to the challenge. And I love how they illustrated the reciprocity norm, that sort of, I'm going to share something vulnerable. And then when Jamie didn't sort of kick in, Roy was like, now it's your turn to kick in with the reciprocity norm. So that was the clip. There's so many lessons that come from it in terms of, I think that what we're doing in negotiation, either if we're a party or a facilitator, what I hope we're doing is problem solving together to work towards optimal outcomes. And I feel like these clips illustrate them beautifully. I think Dave's clip is also a season one clip, and another one of my favorites. So we'll kick it over. I think Dave is next.
Cool.
Go for it, Dave. Great.
Okay. Thank you. So I'm Dave Wolofsky, and I am a negotiation coach and also a career development coach. So I help people get pay raises and promotions mostly, as well as higher starting salaries when they get new jobs. So the clip that we're going to play in a moment is there's two characters here. There's Ted and there's Trent Krim, who is the reporter for the Independent, and he's like a big reporter, and he's writing an article about Ted, and he's shadowing Ted for the whole day in order to write an article about him. And he seems very unfriendly. He's like kind of wants to expose Ted as like a fake or just inept or something like that. And they are at an Indian, or they're at a restaurant, an Indian restaurant. And it's sort of the end of the day that they've been spending with each other. So let's play that clip.
Ted,
mm-hmm.
What you're doing is irresponsible. This club actually means something to this town.
I know that.
I do. Tramp, what do you love?
Is it writing?
Yes.
Yeah, well, good, because you're darn good at it.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Me? I love coaching. Now, I'm going to say this again, just so you didn't think it was a mistake the first time I said it. For me, success is not about the wins and losses. It's about helping these young fellas be the best versions of themselves on and off the field. And it ain't always easy, Trent. But neither is growing up without someone believing in you. Let me ask you this. Is my tongue still in my mouth? Because I am about to hallucinate from all the heat here.
I really should go. Deadlines and all.
Yeah, you gotta do the work. I'll say this, though. I really enjoyed getting to spend this time with you, Trent.
You actually mean that, don't you?
No.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Love this scene. So this may not seem like a negotiation, but it is. And here is why. So basically, you have Trent Crim, who's trying to write an article. And what does he want? He wants to write an article that's going to get a lot of reads, right? A lot of clicks, likes, whatever. And what do those, you know, mostly the articles that get a lot of attention are ones filled with drama. So generally that seems like what he's trying to do, maybe also trying to like tell the truth about Ted. And Ted kind of wants the opposite. He wants, you know, if possible, a friendly article or something like that, or at least sort of a neutral one. And it's interesting because Ted has no leverage in this situation. He really can't offer anything to Trent that's of value to him. So basically, you know, the best case scenario for Ted is for Trent to kind of care less about the drama maybe and care more about Ted as an individual or see him in a positive light. So I just want to go through his tactics that he uses here in this very short time. The first thing he does is he puts a really positive spotlight on Trent. He says, "What do you love?" And Trent is like, "What?" Like, and he's like, "Do you love writing? Because you're good at it." And first of all, it's true. I mean, sure, Trent's a professional writer. And so Trent believes that about himself. And that's important. And to reinforce that. And then second thing Ted does is he explains his own stance and mission in a way that kind of aligns in the same way. It's like, well, you love writing. I love coaching. So he's creating this kind of alignment between their two stories, which creates, again, like affiliation. The third thing he does is he stays confident in his own value that he's adding to the team. And that's really important because, right, he says like, I love coaching and, you know, here's why it's important. It's for the guys to be the best versions of themselves. And that's what he's saying he can deliver, really. And obviously there is some value in that, even if it's kind of like, well, but the wins do matter. You know, it's hard to say, but he really believes it. Fourth thing, he interjects humor, which is always good because it, you know, takes the tension off. Negotiation is inherently a little stressful and can be adversarial and tense. In this case, obviously there's tension. So it diffuses that. And then at the end, he just says, you know, he enjoyed getting to know Trent as a person. So he kept the whole thing pleasant person to person. And so more generally, what I take away from this, and you know, feel free, this might be controversial, feel free to disagree if you do. But the bottom line for me is that there are always two negotiations happening. There's the main one, which is between what you want and what you want to give and what the other person wants and what they want to give you. And then there's the meta negotiation. And the meta negotiation is the experience of negotiating, with you. So it's how the other person feels when they're negotiating with you. And you always want to make every negotiation as pleasant as possible for the other person. If possible, you want to make the experience of negotiating with you enjoyable. And the reason for that is that that in itself is an act of generosity. And when you perform an act of generosity, as Debbie mentioned, the norm of reciprocity, when you're generous, people are triggered to reciprocate with some generosity in return. So if you're very generous about the meta negotiation or the experience of negotiating with you, that triggers a little bit of reciprocity, generosity. I'm going to use that phrase from now on, in the other person. And the thing is, it costs you nothing in terms of the main negotiation, which is, you know, what you're actually asking for. It costs you nothing as long as you stick to the story of why you want or need what you want or need. So if you stay, you know, steady to your theme of what you're trying to get and why, but you are as generous as possible in the meta negotiation and making it a pleasant experience to negotiate with you, you're putting yourself in the best position. So how do you make it pleasant, right? Here's just a couple tips, things that you can do. One thing is, you know, if it's not such a big deal to you, work on the other person's timeline and their schedule. You know, whatever feels like important to them, try to, you know, give those concessions where it's not as important to you. So logistically, meet at their territory, you know, go to their office or whatever, right? Meet on their schedule when it's convenient for them. That's generous. And it doesn't cost you anything in terms of the final outcome. Another thing is paying attention to the other person, as Ted did to Trent. Let them talk, because we all love to talk. And so the more you let them talk and the more you listen, that's also an act of generosity, makes them feel good and enjoy negotiating with you. Also, be confident in your own value. And the reason why that's actually generous to the other person, this is really subtle point here, but if you're excited about providing value for the other person, that is generous to them because they are in this negotiation with you because they believe that you can provide something valuable to them. And if you reinforce that, yes, like this is a good decision for you to be negotiating with me because I have this valuable thing, they're going to actually feel better about spending time negotiating with you because they think they're going to get something good at the end of it. Humor as well, if you can. Make fun of yourself if you have the opportunity and you feel comfortable. It is important to be vulnerable in ways that are not, like, don't lower your value. So for example, if you're negotiating about your salary, you don't want to make a joke about you being not experienced or not skilled enough, but you do want to make jokes perhaps about something like spilling your coffee on your shirt and having to change your shirt or something like that, right? It's not related to the negotiation itself, but it makes you more vulnerable. And vulnerability also, you know, is more pleasant to negotiate with someone who is vulnerable. Last point I will say is, in this case, Ted did not have any leverage really to give Trent. But in your negotiations, you generally will. And whatever leverage you think you have, meaning ways things you can give the other person or ways you can hurt the other person. There's other types of leverage too, but those are the big two. You never want to bring up what leverage in a threatening way. Like, oh, I'm not going to, I could not give you this, or I could do this thing that could harm you. Unless you're in a battle of some kind where, like, if you definitely know the other person means you harm, which is very rare, you should always mention leverage that you have in a way that shows the other person that you have no desire to use it against them. So you might say something like, or you want them to feel that your belief is like, I see it as my job to keep you safe from doing this thing. If you've heard, like, you know, the mafia, like where they're like, oh, it's a beautiful family you have. It'd be a shame if something happened to them, right? So that's a threat. But if you said that genuinely, it's a beautiful family you have. I mean, you wouldn't really say it's a shame if something happened to them, but like I see it as my job to make sure that I'm helping you, your life be better. And even if the other person know, you know, if you could potentially harm them, which we can all harm each other in various ways, just the more you can position yourself as being on their side, that's how you want to do it. So I just said a lot, just talking a little quickly, but that's all I got for you.
Great. Thank you, Dave.
Thank you.
Okay, so I am going to share the last clip here. And so for those of you who don't know, my name is Josh Weiss. So I'm the co-director of the Global Negotiation Initiative at the Program on Negotiation. I have my own consulting company called Negotiation Works, and then I run a master's program at a smaller university in Western Massachusetts called Bay Path University, Master's in Leadership and Negotiation. Anyways, enough of that. So the negotiation, first of all, the hardest part of all of this was picking one of these because there's so many. But the one that I find and I really found quite intriguing was what I call the Zava negotiation. So for those of you who don't know, and this is from season 3, episode 2, Zava was a superstar who became available, and all of the teams, many of the teams in the league were vying to get him. And so it became a negotiation in many ways between these different clubs to entice Zava to come. And originally, as the conversation happened, it looked like he was going to go to a club called Chelsea, which is one of the better clubs and things along those lines. But then something started to happen, and there was some doubt, and there were rumors flying around. And Leslie Higgins, who's the chief of football operations, started to plant the seed that maybe that wasn't going to happen. He wasn't going to go to Chelsea, but that maybe he would go to West Ham, which is AFC Richmond's rival, and in particular is run by Rupert, who is Rebecca's husband and or ex-husband, I should say. And their relationship throughout all of the seasons is a very tenuous one. It's very difficult. Rupert is constantly belittling Rebecca and holding all kinds of things over her head. But what was really interesting, so at the Chelsea game, Zava shows up, and Chelsea is playing Richmond, and Zava comes and he's sitting in the box and gets a big welcome and things along those lines. And Higgins continually says, you know, that Chelsea is going to get him, don't worry about it. And Rebecca is getting a sinking feeling because Rupert always gets what he wants, according to Rebecca. And there's a fascinating conversation that she has with, that Rebecca has with Keely Jones, her compatriot. And she's explaining how she met Rupert. And she says she was working at a bar, and he came every night for 6 weeks until she would go out with him. Now, he happened to also be married. But what she said to Keely about persuasion is really interesting. This is the quote. She said, "I just felt so lucky because he wanted me. He made me feel special, chosen. He made me feel like that," pointing to Rupert and Zava, who were talking and laughing. And so before you know it, now everybody believes that Zava is going to go to West Ham. And Rebecca, throughout this whole process in so many ways, her negotiation style is really avoiding and accommodating in many ways, particularly when it comes to Rupert. And after she sees Rupert leave and they're smiling and et cetera, she says, you know, if Rupert can sweet talk Zava, then so can I. And she decides to go down into the basement of the stadium and try to find Zava to convince him to come play for AFC Richmond. And AFC Richmond is not as good a team as Chelsea or West Ham. And ultimately she finds Zava's bodyguard, and she asks if she can see him. Basically the bodyguard says nobody goes in to see Zava. And then Rupert shows up, and maybe he purposely left his sunglasses behind. But the bodyguard shakes his hand, et cetera. And then Zava comes out of the room that he's in. And Rupert, in a very backhanded way, introduces Rebecca to Zava, saying, "This is my ex-wife." And Rebecca says, "And I'm the owner of AFC Richmond." And Zava, being the superstar that he is, says, "It's a pleasure for you to meet me." Of course, the superstar treatment. And it's at that point where this gets really interesting, because Rupert then leaves and Rebecca gets up the courage to go have a conversation. I would say it was a negotiation. And I'm going to stop there and show you the clip, and then we'll unpack what happens here. Try not to laugh too hard.
You are such a fucking chicken shit. I mean, if you were great, truly great, you could play anywhere. But instead you choose a club like West Ham because it's big and shiny, and you know that they'll win whether you're there or not. And you'll never have to wonder if you're still as good as you tell everyone you are. But you and I know that you're not. You're overrated. You're overpaid. And you eat too much fucking asparagus.
So the last line may very well be but one of the greatest lines in the history of television. Anyways, so that's the negotiation that I want to focus in on. But what I want to just mention is that after that scene, she goes back and to the seats where she's sitting with Keeley. And Keeley says, did you sweet talk him? And Rebecca says, what's the opposite of that? And Keeley thinks for a moment and says, sour yell. And Rebecca goes, yes, I did that. And what I take away from this is a couple of things going on. First of all of these, you know, in negotiation, we're constantly dealing with incomplete information, right? We don't know what's going on, especially in a negotiation like this, where there's different teams involved. And so rumors and innuendos circulate, right? And that leads us to make assumptions and bring our perception to the table about what's going on and what's going to happen. And you can see throughout the entire clip, a series of assumptions being made that are driving people's behavior. So that's the first thing. Then you have this whole notion of persuasion and how do you go about persuading people? And I think when you're dealing in the unique case of a superstar like Zava, he's so used to being coddled and talked to in a, you're the greatest person ever and things like that. Right? And that's what Rupert did. He towed the party line and fully expected that Zava would go down this road and sign with him. But we also see Rebecca deciding, wait a minute, I'm tired of accommodating. I'm tired of losing out in this way. And so she actively decides to change her negotiation style. And she, in many ways, you know, we talk about the idea of negotiation jujitsu, of doing the opposite of what it is that the other person would expect in a negotiation. And when you're dealing with a superstar, that negotiation, that approach, clearly was not what he expected. And I'm pretty sure that she didn't really think it was going to work. And in many ways, it probably wouldn't. But there's an interesting element to this of what speaks to somebody in that role, right? If you're a superstar, we often hear about how people, when they're challenged, that speaks to them, as opposed to just telling them what they want to hear. And so I think when we view this, we initially think there's no chance that he's going to pick her up on this offer because of how offensive she just was to him. But if you view it from Zava's point of view, he looked at her and you could see him, you know, through some of those expressions, even though he had sunglasses on, thinking, wait a minute, maybe there's something here that I should think about, and that I won't be great if I go to a great team, but I could be great if I go to a lesser team and make them great. And so, you know, I think on some level, to Dave's point and what other people have touched on, that ability to speak to an underlying interest that may not be articulated, that may not be clear at all, but that goes to the heart of who somebody is, you know, challenging a competitive athlete to take a team who isn't great and make them great. Well, now you've shown the world how good you really are, right? So I loved this. I loved the fact that she was capable of asserting strongly for herself, if you will, and also delivering a message to somebody in a way that was very different than I think what everybody else would have done. And sometimes, you know, the truth hurts, but it also sometimes shines a light in a place where people don't want to look and gives them an opportunity to say, maybe I'll go down that road. So I love that clip. I love the whole idea of the series of negotiations that lead to this and then ultimately to her getting him to come. So I'm going to stop there. And I would love to open it up for questions. We're going to take questions till about 1 o'clock Eastern time. So for about 10 minutes, depending on where you are. And then before Keld leaves, I want to show you one last clip that, as I mentioned, that I really think is important from a negotiation point of view. So let me go ahead and open it up here. Absolutely. We'll get you a recording of the session. It'll make it available on LinkedIn, et cetera. But what questions, comments, insights do you bring? You all love this show. You all have your knowledge of negotiation as well. What kind of questions or comments can you offer up? So please go ahead and raise your hand so we can facilitate this a little bit, and that would be terrific. So who's got an idea? Don't be shy, because we don't have much time for shyness. And if you have a question you want to put in the chat, that's fine too.
It's not that often, Josh, that we see negotiation happening in the restroom, huh?
Right. Absolutely. And I think the place where negotiations often happen, there was an element there that played a role, I think, for sure.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
No, Debbie, I was just going to say, and also if folks have other clips or their favorite negotiation scenes that they want to comment on, feel free, but go ahead, Debbie.
Yeah, I'll just mention while people are warming up and getting up the courage to raise a hand or put something in the chat, is one thing that hasn't been totally touched on, but I actually saw it in each of the clips inherently, is the, Dave mentioned two negotiations, but there's a third, which is the negotiation we're always having with ourselves, like constantly sort of in preparation in the moment. I mean, Rebecca was really gearing up because that wasn't her natural style. And I felt like in each of our clips, there was that embedded in there. So I'll pop. Looks like there's some people with questions.
Yeah, that's great. I absolutely agree. Alana?
Hi. Hi, everyone. So the winning and losing isn't everything. I love that, but I kind of wonder how that works when you're talking about negotiation, because I feel like winning and losing is a part of negotiation. So how do you kind of connect what he can? I know that's a strong theme for him, to like what happens really in the real world of negotiation in terms of winning and losing.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give you my take, and then Keld, you can dive in here. First of all, to me, you know, it's an interesting question of what does it mean to win in negotiation? And my answer to that is to meet your objectives. And that doesn't mean that the other side has to lose. It means that you're seeking to meet your objectives as best as possible. And so I think when we view negotiation that way, and we're constantly looking for what does this other person need out of the negotiation, there's always that possibility that the other side, I mean, the other side has to get what they want in negotiation in some way, shape, or form. Otherwise, they're not going to say yes. Right. So I think that's how I often try to approach it, is to say, you win if you're getting what's important to you out of this negotiation, not if you did better than the other, which is often what lots of people think, or if you somehow beat the other, because most of our negotiations are with the same people or organizations over and over again. So if I beat them, I'm really engaging in self-defeating behavior. Keld, what do you think?
I absolutely agree, Joss. I just want to add one thing. I think human beings around the world, we need to make a change of our mindset on how we perceive negotiation. Because unfortunately, you're absolutely right, quite often people perceive negotiation as a win-lose, like a soccer game. We can only win if the counterpart loses. But in majority of the cases, it actually makes sense that we change our mindset and look at negotiation as a group exercise. So the enemy is not the counterpart, it's the challenge, it's the problem we have to solve together. So actually, to me, negotiation is more like a group exercise where we try and figure out how can I win, but not at your expense, and how can you win not at my expense. Now, I know we have very limited amount of time, but I'm sure Josh and I, we could spend hours on this by itself, but we really need to change the mindset on what negotiation could and should be.
Great. I agree. Dave,
also add.
Yeah, let's just, so Dave, let's pick up on some of the questions in the chat if we can. Good. Yeah. Go ahead, Dave.
I also just wanted to add that two things. One is we don't usually know what we want. We think we know what we want and we don't necessarily know. Like, you don't know why you want what you want. And also there's always things to be discovered that the other person could give you that you didn't realize. And then there's also timeline, like how far in the future are you thinking? Is the relationship going to actually be more valuable to you in the long run if you make a concession now that makes you feel like you lost, but it'll actually help you later? So things to think about.
Mm-hmm. Great. So we have quite a few questions here in the chat. So Tracy asks, could you provide some examples of changing up your negotiation style and how it worked for you? I have one quick one and I'll share. I was dealing with somebody who was a very competitive negotiator, and my style has evolved from being accommodating to being more collaborative because I understand now the value of and the importance of asserting for myself, just like Rebecca did in that particular situation. And what I found was that my collaborative approach was not landing. He just continued to be competitive. And so what I ended up doing was engaging a little more competitively, digging in a little bit more, because I sensed that there was something for him. A lot of competitive people like the back and forth, the push, the game, if you will, that goes along with competing approaches, sort of engaging with each other. And when I did that, I noticed that he began to resonate more with that. And there was, somebody mentioned this question about mirroring. You know, he seemed to resonate with that notion, and there was a level of respect that was almost created because I was pushing back as hard as he was, and that changed the dynamic quite significantly, and we were able to get there. If anybody else has another example. Let me see what else we have in the chat here. I do want to make sure that, Kel, do you have to leave at 5 past? Is that what you said? Okay. So let's see. Next question. To be able to have a negotiation, both parties need to show up and engage. Is there a meta negotiation before the negotiation? Good question, Jay. Cool. Anybody want to take that
one? So I would say one of the most powerful things when you're going to have an official negotiation where you're actually, you know, sitting down at a table with, you know, perhaps it's salary negotiation or it's business to business or something. One of the most powerful things you can do is set the kind of ground rules or like the expectations ahead of time. Like, how are you approaching this? And is there anything that you need from me in order to make this a smooth negotiation? And that's like an actual meta negotiation before the negotiation. And I think it's very powerful. It's also actually powerful in relationships when you have to talk about something difficult, like what can I say, or how can I say it to make sure that you can fully hear me or something like that. So yes.
Great. Kel?
Back to that, which is that one of the things that we say is that anytime you're negotiating, you're actually negotiating in three domains, and it's sort of a Venn diagram. There's the substance of what you're negotiating about. There's the relationship that you're always managing, the relationship between you and me, any third party stakeholders. And then there's the process, which is sort of that third piece of the Venn diagram. And I think process is where this meta negotiation comes in. Processes. How are we going to negotiate? What are the conditions? What is the agenda of how we're going to have that negotiation? And so in your preparation, really thinking on all three of those levels, not just what do I want, what do they want, which is substance, which is where we often spend the bulk of our time preparing, but also thinking about where is the relationship now? Where do we want it to be? What is the gap? How might we bridge that gap? And then also process. How might we set the container, and an agenda can be a very helpful way to do that.
Great. Kel, did you want to comment on that or?
Yes, I agree with everything what was being said. I just want to share a little piece of advice, and that is we perceive negotiation very differently. You know, United Nations in New York has never declared an international standard on what negotiation is. So Josh might see negotiation like playing tennis, and I might perceive it as playing chess. So now I'm saying something I know sounds weird, but quite often we need to negotiate on how to negotiate before we start negotiating. So we have to sit down and discuss how do you want to do that. And I agree completely with what you just said, Debbie. There could be everything, tools like which variables are we negotiating, could be the agenda. It could even be verbalizing trust. What is happening if trust is declining? How do we maintain that? And what happens if trust is high and blah, 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 so on and so forth. So yeah, just talk about negotiation even before we start negotiating.
Yeah. So let me take one more that I think is probably on lots of people's mind, and then I want to share that clip before people jump off. What is a good balance between keeping your emotions under control as and versus showing your passion? The mirror talk in video one and the toilet talk in video two. What do you, who wants to tackle that one? Anybody? Dave?
So yeah, one of the, I think research on this has shown that a really effective way of doing this is you start very pleasant, very warm. And as the negotiation goes along, you get more and more neutral. And I would say, and that makes people feel more like, okay, they have to like work with you. I don't know why, but that's what research has shown. And I would say it's very rarely, like if you interject just like one, you know, I don't know, 5%. One out of 20 times you actually have some passion. That's what I would think of as like effective.
Great. I'm going to leave it there for 1 second because I'd love Kel to show this last clip and we can come back and continue for a few more minutes after. But this is perhaps many people's favorite scene from Ted Lasso. And when you see it, you'll understand a bit why. There is an underlying message here that I think is critical for negotiation. Because negotiation is, we're always working with incomplete information, it's an exploration process. And I love the way that Ted teases out what is going on in this particular scenario. So Keld, if you could share this clip and then we'll come back, I would appreciate it.
You're on. Okay. Double in, double out.
Whatever you say, Rupadoops. Yeah, just... let me know if I'm winning or losing, all right?
Oh, I forgot I had these on me.
Oh, yeah. Oh, wait a second. I forgot I'm left-handed.
Yes! 180!
William Rupert, get in!
Shut your stupid little twat mouth, or I will shut it for you.
Shall I be giving you the lineup card now, Ted? I shall be putting your Bassania back on defense where he belongs.
That's exactly what I said, didn't I?
No, it's not all Ted's fault. My ex-wife's the one who brought the hillbilly to our shores. I know she's always been a bit randy, but I never thought she would fuck over an entire team.
Hey! Better manners when I'm holding a dart. Please. Mate, what do I need to win?
2 triple 20s and a bullseye.
Good luck.
You know, Rupert, guys have underestimated me my entire life. And for years, I never understood why. It used to really bother me. But then one day, I was driving my little boy to school, and I saw this quote by Walt Whitman. It was painted on the wall there. It said, "Be curious, not judgmental." And I like that. So I get back in my car, and I'm driving to work. And all of a sudden, it hits me. All them fellas that used to belittle me, not a single one of them were curious. You know, they thought they had everything all figured out, and so they judged everything, and they judged everyone. And I realized that they're underestimating me. Who I was had nothing to do with it. Because if they were curious, they would ask questions. You know? Questions like, "Have you played a lot of darts, Ted?" Which I would have answered, "Yes, sir." Every Sunday afternoon at a sports bar with my father from age 10 till I was 16 when he passed away. Barbecue sauce.
Rebecca, Ted, enjoy your evening.
Mate, as always.
Oh, shit, that felt good.
was fun. Yeah.
Only one thing left to do now.
What's that?
So, as you can see from that scene, and I probably should have set it a little bit up there, where Rupert and Ted were playing darts to control the lineup and for Rupert to continue to have some control over AFC Richmond, even though he gave it up in the divorce. But the point is that, you know, when we bring a curious mindset to the negotiation table, doors open, possibilities open. When we come in and we're judgmental, when we think we have all of the answers, when we're so sure of our point of view or our perspective, that's when we get into trouble. So I think if you can bring a curious mindset to the table, think about your role as asking questions and gathering information, because if we're working with incomplete information, that's what we need to do. And I think it's brilliant. And it encapsulates, I think, in so many ways, how to become a really great negotiator, because I've never met somebody who isn't a great negotiator who brings that way of thinking to the table. So we've got a little, I'm happy to stay a little longer if folks want to stay and pick up on some questions. I will say that I did want to mention two quick things. And Shane, I don't know if you can go ahead and share those links in the chat. Just so you know, there are two other sessions that we're just wanting to promote here. One is tomorrow at noon with Keld on negotiation strategy. And then the other one is an interview that I'm going to be doing with William Urey, my good friend and colleague, on Friday at 3 p.m. Eastern on the art of the possibilist, as he calls it. So for those of you who do need to leave, thank you so much for coming. We hope this was what you imagined. I loved it. It was great. And as I said, we could keep going for a long time. And there will be a recording of this that we will share so folks can pick up on that. But I'm happy to stay for a few more minutes, and if other folks would like to, and we'll try to maybe tackle some of these other questions. But Keld, I know you need to jump off. Thank you so much, my friend, for coordinating.
Yeah, and thank you for arranging everything, Joss. And Shane, thank you for being an author of the whole thing and the creator of this whole month. Well done. Yeah, I got a pop off. Thank you, everybody. Guys, I'm off.
So Debbie and Dave, can you stay? Maybe we'll just try to tackle these last couple of questions that are in here.